a couple things. So we're going to talk about colloids today, and there's a lot to say. This morning, I'll sort of give you a background in the various kinds of colloidal interactions. We'll see how far we get, all right? But before we do that, I just wanted to summarize some things. Some of it we already talked about yesterday. So colloids are particles suspended in a liquid. They come in sizes from roughly 2 nanometers to 2 microns. We typically measure their concentration in the volume fraction of particles. So that can actually can be as high as you want if your particles have different sizes. But if they all have the same size, the maximum density you can get is 74% by volume, which is the volume fraction of a close-packed structure like an FCC or an HCP lattice. One thing to keep in mind about colloids is that they come in quite a broad spectrum of materials. We can make them out of plastics, out of inorganic materials like silicon dioxide or titanium dioxide. We can make them out of metals like gold and silver. Matter of fact, gold colloids have been used for centuries. They're used in stained glass windows, for example. They were used famously by Michael Faraday back in the 19th century. Some of his gold colloidal suspensions that he made back in the 1830s, 1840s are still on display at the Royal Society in London. You can actually see them. They're just fine. They're nice and stable. As we said yesterday, they can be made out of other things like proteins or viruses. Milk is a colloidal suspension of fats and proteins. So they're little particles, about half micron particles suspended in water. So they're all over the place. The other thing I mentioned is there are emulsions, and you can consider emulsions as a type of colloid. There, the particle, instead of being solid, is a liquid droplet, but you can have the same range of sizes, and to some extent, you can think of emulsions as a kind of colloid, and most of the things that we have to say about colloids made from solid particles suspended in a liquid also apply to emulsions. And then we also talked about sols and gels. Now, I wanted to show you this so that you got a sense of what they actually look like, since I could only talk about that a little bit yesterday. These in the literature are some of the most famous pictures of colloidal crystals. They're from a paper right here by Peter Pusey and Bill Van Magen, published in Nature in 1986. All right, so if you can see these, you can see that there's various colors. These, the volume fractions are given up here. This, the highest volume fraction is 52.5%. The lowest one is 39.4%. And what they're showing is a phase transition. Down here at 39.4%, what you see is a homogeneous disordered suspension of colloidal particles. Essentially, at 39.4% and below, the colloidal particles don't touch each other, and they just move around by Brownian motion, and they take up random positions. All right, so as such, you can think of them as a liquid. The colloids themselves form a colloidal liquid, and so they scatter light, and so what you see is sort of a uniform color here. Now, as you raise the volume fraction, actually, I put sort of the wrong volume fractions down, but that's okay. At this volume fraction, what you see is the system is phase separated. On the bottom part, you have a crystalline phase, and on the top part, you have a liquid phase. And in the crystalline phase, if you look at it, you can see some colors. And as you increase the concentration, the amount of crystalline phase increases and the amount of liquid phase decreases here, here, and then here you get 100% crystal. Here you get 100% crystal, here 100% crystal, and then over here you form a glass phase, all right? That is, the equilibrium, equilibrium condition here would be for this to be a completely crystalline phase, but in fact what they found was that you get a crystal up on top and a glass on the bottom. Over here, they got a little bit of crystal on top and a lot of glass on the bottom. This was published, like I said, in 1986. Around the year 2000, some experiments were done where they took colloids like this and they took them into the space shuttle and watched them crystallize under zero gravity. And what they discovered was something a little bit surprising, and that is that samples like this crystallized all the way through. So in fact, the fact that this one doesn't crystallize here, the fact that it forms a glass, is in part influenced by gravity. And when you remove gravity, you can get the whole sample to crystallize, although eventually you do see at very high volume fractions glassy phases emerge even in microgravity. An interesting, these pictures up here are a little hard to see. These down here are a little bit easier. These are two pictures of opals, all right, the gemstone. Opals are dried out, petrified colloidal suspensions, basically of silica particles, all right? So in the sediment in the ocean, you can get, or ages ago, you had colloidal silica, and it sedimented and it formed crystals. And the crystals are of the right lattice spacing such that they Bragg scatter light. So these colors you see are Bragg reflections. The reason you see green here, orange here, red here, blue here is simply because you're looking at Bragg scattering off of different crystalline planes due to there being different crystallites in here that are oriented in different directions so that you pick up different colors depending upon the angle that you look at the material with. But this is what I wanted to show you. You see the same thing up here. It's a little harder to see just because the picture isn't as clear, but you get the same kind of Bragg scattering up here. So this is one way of recognizing colloidal crystals. Yes? Yes? They're very stable. They'll stay like this for years. All right. Now, if you don't touch them, all right.
I asked
that
how stable are these against temperature?
What?
Against temperature.
I'm sorry?
Against temperature. You increase the temperature.
If I raise the temperature. Ah, that's an interesting question. If you raise the temperature, nothing will happen, all right? Now, the reason for that is fairly simple. Here's the potential. All right, the potential is a function of R is so let's call this distance 2R. All right, that's the diameter of a particle. So as a function of distance, the potential is 0 and then infinity. All right, now, if you think about it, the way that temperature is going to come in, just from statistical mechanics, is you're going to get factors of the Boltzmann, you get Boltzmann factors, e to the beta u of r. All right? But u can be 0, in which case this is 1 for r greater than 2r, or u can be infinity, in which case this is 0 for r less than 2r. So for this potential, what you see is that your Boltzmann factors have no temperature in it. It's an athermal system, all right? And so to the extent that this that the potentials between these particles are good, are well approximated by a hard sphere potential, there shouldn't be any temperature dependence. Now, of course, that's an approximation. There is some temperature dependence. There is some R dependence here. But in fact, it's so small as to be inconsequential. And as a practical matter, these suspensions have a phase diagram that doesn't depend upon temperature. The only way it depends upon temperature is if you get it hot enough, the water will boil off. If you get it hotter, the polymethylmethacrylate spheres will burn up. But other than that, there's no temperature dependence to these. This is actually an interesting thing to keep in mind about colloids. For the most part, I'll give you some exceptions to this, but for the most part, temperature doesn't change things very much. Temperature usually isn't a variable that you can manipulate to any great effect. All right. Now, all statements like this, it's a little bit of a lie what I've told you, but it's sort of the zeroth order approximation. And I'll give some examples of when it breaks down. But mostly, temperature doesn't play a big role with colloids. All right. So I just wanted to show you these because they give you an idea of what these things look like. So let's get rid of that for now. And I'm not sure how to blank this out, so I'll just pull the plug. All right. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about today, briefly, is Brownian motion, all right? Because I want to just say a few things about that. I won't dwell on it too long because you've already talked a bit about it in some other lectures. But the basic idea is if you look at a particle in suspension, all right, so this is your colloid, say its diameter is on the order of 1 micron, then there are solvent molecules, water or whatever else it is all around. Of course, these are at a finite temperature. So they're moving around, in particular, they're colliding with the particle. And so the particle is buffeted around by these collisions. And as a result, you get Brownian motion. Now, the sort of simplest treatment of Brownian motion, or sort of most obvious one, is just to apply Newton's second law in a straightforward way. So you have m times dv dt, where v is the velocity of the particle. There's a drag force, which is proportional to v. All right. So this is the drag coefficient. And for spheres, this is 6 pi eta times the particle radius. All right. Now, in addition to this, all right, so this just takes account of the fact that if the particle, say, is moving to the right, it will encounter more collisions than on the left, which will push it back and will resist motion, than on the right than on the left. All right, so this is in the opposite direction of flow. Then you have a stochastic term, this force that comes from the encounters of the solute with the solvent with the particles. All right, so one thing to keep in mind is what the characteristic time scale is for these forces. So if you look at the aggregate force of all these particles on here, F is a function of time, there's some force that's fluctuating around, but the time scale of these fluctuations is something like picoseconds, all right? That is, the time scale of the fluctuations is the time scale having to do with how often the particles collide with the solute molecules collide with the particle. So for example, if you were to measure the autocorrelation function of these forces, say you dot them together in average, you would get something that would decay. So I'll just write that as FF, it's a function of T. You get something that would decay again on a time scale of picoseconds. All right? So what people do, so first of all, my claim is going to be that that's a fast time scale and we can approximate in a simple way. Now, the reason for that is to take a closer look at the equation and notice that based on these two terms, there's a natural time scale in the system. So just in terms of dimensional analysis, V here and V here have the same units. You have a time. So if you bring that over here and bring this over here, you have a characteristic time, tau, which is m over the friction coefficient. So if you take the mass of a typical colloidal particle, all right, say a 1 micron particle, and you also calculate the drag coefficient associated with, say, that sphere in water, what you find is that this time comes out to be on the order of something like 10 to the minus 7 seconds. Right? It varies depending upon the viscosity. If the viscosity is higher, this can be a bit slower. If the particle is smaller, it can be a bit smaller. But it's on that order. So the point is, this is on the order of picoseconds, you know, 10 to the minus 12 seconds or less. So what's typically done is you approximate this force by a delta function. All right, it's an approximation. I actually always dislike the way people talk about this because they just say this as though it's obvious. They say it's a delta function, it has white noise and all this blah, 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 blah. All right, it's not that hard. It just has a time scale having to do with molecular collisions. The noise isn't perfectly white. It's white up to a frequency of 10 to the 12 hertz. So that's what's done. So I'm not going to go through the solution of this because I think you've already gone through the solution of this. It's a stochastic equation, and what you have to do is come up with some expression for this. The main thing is, as you say, it's proportional to delta of t because of this separation of time scales. Then you have to weight it properly so that your average of v squared comes out to be the equipartition value. Let's say it's, I'll write v alpha, one component of v squared. Has to be equal to kT over m just from equipartition. All right, so that's how you choose the magnitude of this force so that it gives you the right answer. Other than that, you just say it's delta function correlated. Now, if you go through that, what you get is you can get an expression for the mean square displacement as a function of time. and I'll write it down. It comes out, this is 3D now, so it comes out to be 6 kBT over delta, and then T minus tau times 1 minus e to the minus t over tau. All right, where tau is this here. All right, and you can take limits of this. You can take the limit of it in short time. For a short time, say t close to 0, this term is essentially 0, and so you get this, that this is equal to kBT over, it's 6 kBT over zeta times t for t much less than tau. We like this, and this is correct, all right? That is, if you remember from when you have diffusion, in diffusion, you expect that the mean square displacement, r squared, is equal to 6 dt. All right. So what this result says is it says that the diffusion coefficient is kBt over the friction coefficient. This is known as the Einstein, or sometimes the Stokes Einstein relation. And this, pardon? Oh, this, sorry. Yeah. This is much greater. I actually said the wrong thing. I'm going to fix it up in a second. So when it's much greater, this is 0, so this is tau. T is much greater than tau, so we end up ignoring that term. Sorry. Thank you. All right, so that's T much greater than tau. At t much less than tau, it's a little bit more subtle. So you're going to expand this term. It's going to be 1 minus t minus over tau. So the 1 will be canceled by this. You'll have a minus t over tau. That tau will cancel that. You'll have a t minus t. So that term goes to 0. So you actually have to expand this out to second order. So the second order term is the term that survives, and it's just going to be 1 half t over tau squared plus higher order terms. All right, so what that means is, and actually that's for that term, and then there's then it's times a tau. All right, so when you put that all together, you actually end up getting a result that this is 3 kBT over m times t squared. All right, so this t squared is the first term that survives. In going from here to here, we've used the fact that m is equal to tau times the friction coefficient from this over here. All right. So what you see is that it's quadratic at short times. So if you plot this up, r squared versus time, you get something that starts out quadratic and then goes to a straight line. So the straight line has this slope of d, and here you have this quadratic behavior, which suggests that r squared goes quadratically in time, as r goes linearly in time, so you say it's ballistic motion. This part, all right, is wrong, all right? It's used all the time. It's in practically every stat mech book. I'd say probably, I don't know, maybe a quarter of the authors know that it's wrong, maybe fewer. it's still not a bad thing to do because largely it's used for purposes of illustration. That is, this approach of putting in a noise term into an equation of motion and approximating the noise term by a delta function appears in all sorts of contexts for different models in statistical mechanics, and it usually works very well. It's just that here it's wrong, all right? So I want to emphasize that. It's not sort of right, it's wrong, all right? And I'll show you. I won't go through the full theory, but I'll explain it to you because the full theory is complicated. But the physical ideas behind it aren't so complicated. So what's wrong with it? The main problem with it is that this part right here. All right. The problem is that we've assumed in this theory that the drag is equal to a constant. All right. If you wait long enough, it's a constant, but it's not a constant instantaneously. All right. So one way to think about the problem is this. Suppose you are sitting in a boat. All right, here's you sitting in a boat, relaxing, all right, on your chair in a boat, floating along, all right, and you're just sitting there, all right. Then your friend comes up and gives the boat a push, all right. Now, what's going to happen to the boat, all right? The boat's going to start to move. And eventually, it will slow down and stop again. Why? Because of the drag by the water. All right. But let me ask you this. Does the water provide a constant drag? The answer is no, because when you push on this boat and the boat starts moving, it drags some water along with it. All right. So when you push on it, you push on the boat, but in fact you start the water underneath it moving. And that water underneath it moving will keep the boat moving longer than it would have had you had some magical power that you could keep the water from moving if the water just stayed there. All right. But it actually gets a velocity and it moves with the boat. And because of that, it takes the boat longer to slow down than it would have otherwise. Exactly the same thing is happening here with the colloidal particle. All right. When the thermal forces give it a shove and it starts to move, it drags the surrounding fluid with it. All right. So in order to do this this problem right, you can't use this very simple treatment of the hydrodynamics that ignores the motion of the solvent. You have to include it. All right. Now, it actually has a little bit of an interesting history. And it was discovered that there was a problem with this picture because of some simulations that were done back in the 1960s. All right, so back in the 1960s, this is the very early days of doing computer simulations. And a couple of researchers in the United States, Alder and Wainwright, were doing some experiments, doing some computer simulations of liquids. And what they looked at was they looked at the velocity autocorrelation function. So that's V of T0 times V of T0 plus T average, all right? Now, if you calculate the velocity autocorrelation function for this model, it comes out in the same solution that gives you this. What you get is, let's put a dot here, all right? Or let's say, not put a dot, let's do one component, the x component, y component, z component, they'll all be the same. For this model, what you'll get, well, at zero time, you have to get equal partition. So you'll get KBT over M. And then it turns out you get a result that's not too surprising at all, e to the minus t over tau, that tau there. That's it. A nice, simple result. All right. What Alder and Wainwright noticed was when they calculated the velocity autocorrelation function, not of colloids, but just of liquid, they were simulating liquid argon, what they discovered is not an exponential decay. They discovered a decay that asymptotically went as t to the minus 3/2 power. All right. This is so a power law decay. And as you probably know, power laws decay much more slowly than exponentials. All right. So it remained something of a mystery until about 1970. And there was a paper published by Zwanzig and Bixen, I'll give you the references in a minute, where they proposed the solution, that the problem was with assuming that the friction coefficient was a constant. All right. It was worked out. They didn't get an analytical solution. The math is messy. But later on, John Hinch at Cambridge worked out an analytical solution for this. And you can look it up. So here I want to show you just a graph of the two solutions and discuss it just a little bit. Just that it's a more complicated Langevin equation. So here's Alder and Wainwright, the guys who did the simulation. Here's the paper by Zwanzig and Bixen, their first paper where they figured this out. Here's a paper by Hinch where he got an analytical solution for it. And so what I've plotted up here on log scale is the two solutions. So this is for a 1 micron polystyrene particle suspended in water, all right? And here is this exponential solution. You see it dies very quickly on a log plot, and it comes up here, and it goes to the correct value at zero time. This is the solution by Hinch at long time. So here your drag coefficient actually is a time-dependent drag coefficient because of this effect of dragging the solvent along with it. So at long times, it gives the correct t to the minus 3/2 power. And then you follow it back to zero time, and there's a little bit of a problem here, all right, because it doesn't go back to the correct equipartition value. And we believe in equipartition. That's right, all right? So something's left out of his theory. And that, what's left out of his theory, is described by a second paper by Zwanzig and Bixen in 1975. And it's actually the idea is fairly simple. If done right, pardon. Even for equal mass particles, you get this long time tail. Or so even in
for equal mass case, you get a long time tail. But for a big particle in a gas, do you still get a long time tail?
Big particle in a gas. I don't see why not. I don't see that there's any fundamental difference. You might have to start worrying about mean free paths at that point, because if the mean free path, yeah, you probably have to worry about it, because at some stage the mean free path of the gas molecules becomes comparable to the size of the colloid, and then I think you have other things to worry about, but I don't know. And there's another thing here, in Hinch's solution. Hinch has assumed that the fluid, the liquid, the solvent, is incompressible, all right? And it's that assumption that leads to this discrepancy here, the fact that the liquid is incompressible. So the right, if you extrapolate this back yet another decade back to here, all right, what you see is here's Hinch's solution coming in like this. And if you go back another decade, not too far, and this is the KBT over M result, you see that this goes up like that. All right. This time scale here is essentially the diameter of the particle divided by the velocity of sound. All right. So if the velocity of sound in water is about 1400 meters per second, if you put in that 2R equals 1 micron, you get something. I actually calculated it. You get that this is that this time tau is about 0.67 nanoseconds. All right. So what happens? Physically, what happens in the liquid is that the particle gets its full kT of energy. All right. It moves. All right. The fluid on this time scale is a little bit compressible, so it compresses the fluid. But that sound wave very quickly slows it down a bit, and some of its momentum is imparted to the fluid. All right. So if you want to think of it, this kT over m here after this velocity of sound time, this kT of energy is imparted some to the particle and some to the surrounding fluid. All right. So equipartition still works, but you have to take this into account. Yeah.
How does the velocity of sound come into the?
The velocity of sound comes in because on very short time scales, when the particle moves, the liquid is actually compressible. All right. There is some finite compressibility to any liquid. All right. And so the particle moves, but the liquid compresses a little bit, all right. But what that ends up doing is that it ends up imparting some momentum from the particle back to the fluid, all right. So initially there's some compression, gives some momentum to the fluid. And then the rest of it is described by this Hinch theory. And because the fluid starts moving with the particle, it takes much longer for the velocity autocorrelation function to decay than it would in this simple model where the drag is constant. All right. So I wanted to plot this up, and I wanted to actually do it with the real equations, all right, just to show you how wrong the theory is. I mean, this theory, the only thing it gets right about the the decay of the autocorrelation function is essentially the characteristic time. All right, the characteristic time here is still something like the friction coefficient over m, but other than that, everything else is wrong. All right, so you should just know that. Part of the reason why I know so much about this is because about 30 years ago, we did some experiments that actually measured this and showed that the Hinch theory gives the right answer and the classic Langevin theory gives the wrong answer. All right, so, and since then, there have been more experiments that have verified this. So it's very well established. Yeah. Actually, the way is it of the form what?
What is the form of zeta t?
All right. So actually, the way it's done. All right. If you go to the, you have to go to the Hinch paper, and you'll see why I don't go through it all. But he actually Laplace transforms the equations of motion. All right. So so this zeta, all right, in his formulation, is actually a function of frequency. Okay, so he specifies essentially the Laplace transform of this, All right, and then it's like most things when you do solutions this way. He gets a nice, neat, compact solution of the Laplace transform. It's not even very long. And then he Laplace transforms it, and he gets this horrible-looking thing with complex error functions, all right? And so that's when you just go to a computer and you plot it up, all right? Which is also why Zwanzig and Bixen didn't come up with an analytical solution in their first try. All right, yeah. The diffusion constant comes out to be the same in both cases. Yeah, the power law goes to zero, all right, and the diffusion coefficient is the integral of the velocity autocorrelation function, as perhaps you know, and the integral of the autocorrelation function with the long time tail gives the correct, gives the same diffusion coefficient, that is kt over xi, over zeta, all right? So that's why I said the long time behavior of the simple Langevin treatment is correct, all right? It's only the short time predictions that are wrong, all right? And the long time just predicts diffusive behavior. It gets the diffusion coefficient correct. Other questions? Okay. It's absolutely right. And there's nothing right about the classical theory. Nothing, 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 nothing. It's wrong. The only thing it gets right is the time scale and the long time behavior. But the short time behavior, which is what the velocity autocorrelation function deals with, is just completely wrong. All right? It's funny because it's a point that's not widely appreciated. I don't know why. But it's just not correct. Okay. So you can surprise people and get into arguments about this if you want, but it is well verified.
There's this one Nature paper, right? I guess like last year, where they look at the nanosecond time scale.
Yes. There was a paper a few years ago that looked at the short time behavior, and they saw the same thing. They see through the long time tails too. All right. Well, the ballistic. You see, the thing is the ballistic regime in some sense is just this regime here. All right. And to my knowledge, there's no measurements of that, all right? That is only theory.
I thought this experiment measured that.
No, the experiment measures from here on out, all right? So these experiments, ones that we did and the more recent ones, it measures this function, all right? But to do this, you have to get sub-nanosecond resolution. And the distance this moves is tiny. It's just absolutely minuscule. Probably a few angstroms. I didn't calculate it out. You can calculate it. See, ask how far it moves if it's going at kt, square root of kt over m in 0.67 nanoseconds. But my guess is it's an angstrom or so. All right? So to my knowledge, nobody has been able. I mean, it's a hard measurement, right? Because you have a 1-micron-sized particle, and you have to resolve its motion to less than an angstrom. All right, so it's quite difficult to do. But since this part's been well verified, and we all believe in equipartition, I think this part's almost certainly correct. Other questions? Okay, we can put this back up for now. Pardon? Wait, who's? Yeah, all right, speak up because I'm a long ways away from you.
So, can you write a velocity dependent Langevin equation to give me that solution?
Like I said, the way you get the solution, you look it up in the Hinge paper. You can't write down a simple, at least I don't know of any simple closed form of zeta of t. The way you do it, I mean the way he did it, is to Laplace transform the equation of motion and to solve it that way. It's fairly straightforward that way. And then you do get an expression for the Laplace transform of zeta, so it's essentially a frequency dependent zeta. So I guess you could Laplace transform that and get a time dependent one. I haven't done it. The noise term is still there. It's still delta, and Hinch's theory, he still uses a delta function for the noise term. All right. So that part isn't changed. So the problem isn't in the noise term. The problem is in the friction term. All right. Oh, was it done in gas?
And at low pressure, so that time scale becomes
wrong. Perhaps so. Okay, so I don't okay, it could be. I don't remember the details of that. It's been a while, a long time since I looked at it. Yeah.
How do you estimate this time scale?
Which time scale?
Physical to 2R by V of sound. What is the physical picture behind this?
I'm not sure I understand the question. I mean, yes.
Then what about this short time behavior? Means how do you?
Well, the short time behavior is essentially that's this time right here. And the way I estimate it is it's the time it takes for a sound wave in the solution, in the solvent, to travel one particle diameter. All right. Which is like about 2/3 of a nanosecond for.
If you are taking a picture that this particle is moving inside a fluid, and with the minimum time, how much means what is the adjacent particle motion?
So the my picture is that you have this particle being jostled around. All right, it has energy of kT. All right. That means it's root mean square velocity is the square root of 3 kT over m from equipartition. All right. But that's what it is right now. When you ask, what about velocity correlations? That is, if it's moving in this direction, say to your right now, what will it be doing in some short time later? All right. If the time is less than about 2/3 of a nanosecond, it will still be moving in the same direction, and it will be imparting, creating a sound wave in the liquid because it will be compressing the liquid. It's like, you know, it's like a bullet or a ball hitting the liquid, and it makes it creates a sound wave because it compresses the liquid slightly. However, these liquids, water, are not highly compressible, all right? So it only compresses it a tiny bit, all right? What that does then is it imparts some momentum, some of the momentum m times v that the particle has due to the thermal energy, it imparts some of that momentum to the fluid around it. So the fluid around it, so if this thing's moving this way, the fluid around it starts moving that way too, all right? So then the picture is, that I've started the fluid moving that way, and so the particle moves in that wake, and so the friction, zeta, all right, is reduced, is smaller than what you would have expected had you assumed that the fluid was stationary, all right, and so stationary isn't quite right. Let me state it a little bit more precisely, all right. Precisely what this assumption of a constant zeta is if I have a particle falling like this, then I have fluid flow that looks, you know, like this, the usual Stokes flow around the liquid. But that's flow for the steady state. This flow field is a flow field that assumes that this thing is not only moving at a velocity v, but it's been moving at a velocity v since the Big Bang. All right. Back to infinity. Because it takes time to set up this flow field. And the point is, when this thing is jostling around, so it's moving this way at one moment, then it's moving this way, it doesn't instantaneously set up a new flow field. It takes time for that flow field to set up. And that's the origin of the time-dependent friction factor, is the fact that it takes time to set up this flow field. And of course, by the time it gets set up, this thing's already been banged by more molecules, and it's moving in a different direction. All right? So it becomes very complicated. But the net effect is that the friction factor is different than what you would have expected. In some sense, it's initially greater, all right, because the other theory gives you something that goes like this. So in effect, over this period, the friction is greater because it runs into almost a brick wall. And it sort of stops it very, you know, it doesn't stop it, but it slows it down quite a bit almost right away. But when it slows it down, the liquid pays a price. It starts moving too. And so now the subsequent motion after that, the subsequent slowing down of the particle, takes longer. All right? Yeah?
If the long-time behavior is unchanged, then...
No, the long-time behavior is completely changed.
So how is the dynamics affected by this?
Just like this. I mean, this is the answer. The only other thing you need to know is that the diffusivity, which is the integral of the velocity autocorrelation function, is the same in both cases. And the long-time behavior, that is, once the velocity autocorrelation function has decayed effectively to zero, you can decide what zero is, factor of 10, factor of 100, but once it's decayed significantly, then after that, the behavior for the two models is exactly the same, no different. All right, so the long-time behavior is okay, because at long times, you can think of it as, well, this thing has set up whatever flow field is going to set up, and it's had plenty of time to do it. All right, but it's only at short times that you run into the problem. All right. This isn't everything you need to know about colloids, but it's sort of interesting, particularly because every single textbook I've ever read on the subject does it incorrectly. I haven't seen one that does it right. So it is a hard calculation. It's not a trivial.
Uh-huh.
Pardon?
If I look at a time scale which is of order 10 to the minus 6 seconds,
then you're probably okay.
Then I'm okay, right? So this is probably if I look at in the nanosecond.
Yeah. That's another way. So to be concrete about this, for a normal size colloids, if you're looking at time scales longer than about a microsecond, you're fine. So I'm making a big deal out of this. But it's only for time scales less than a microsecond that it really matters. Yeah. Well, by then you're in the long time. By then you've already transitioned. Yeah, this viscous time scale is 10 to the minus 7. So by 10 to the minus 6, at 10 to the minus 8, you're in this regime. Not really. The only place you see t squared, strictly speaking, is for this two-thirds of a nanosecond. That's it.
So the
relaxation time
scale for the fluid.
Pardon?
What is the relaxation?
All right. He asked, what's the relaxation time scale for the fluid? All right. Actually, if you look in the Hinch theory, what you have now, before what you had was, since the fluid was assumed not to move, the only time scale you had was this scale, the mass divided by the friction coefficient. Now, when the fluid starts moving, you essentially have another time scale, which is the displaced mass of the fluid divided by the friction coefficient. So if the fluid has the same density as the particle, then these two time scales are the same. Generally speaking, in a colloidal suspension, the two have comparable densities, and so these two time scales are almost the same, and so you don't notice them, all right? So you actually have to have a very big difference in these two time scales. But what controls this decay is really mostly the time scale associated with the fluid. So that is a subtlety I didn't mention, that you introduce two time scales now, but in most practical situations, they're almost the same. All right, so it doesn't have any consequence. Yes?
The fact that the fluid moves along with the particle basically means a no-slip boundary condition, right?
Yes, it means a no-slip boundary condition.
So if I want to test whether the particle has a finite slip length, then we should get the incorrect expression.
It's true. So you could imagine situations in which you get some slip, all right? And
my question is one of the ways to figure out if you have a finite slip length is to do that measurement.
Yes, you'd have to do it quite accurately in an absolute sense, which is often quite hard to do it accurately in an absolute sense. But people take this theory and they apply it to liquids, all right? Say, let's take liquid argon, since it's more or less a bunch of spheres, where all the particles have the same size. And then the way they sort of fudge it and get around it, which I don't find particularly satisfying, but it's not so bad either, is they introduce a slip length, or they say that the friction factor is no longer 6 pi eta r, but it's, say, 4 pi eta r, which is what you get for one with perfect slip. And of course, their computer simulations, where they can test all this very accurately, they can see what it turns out to be, and it's not quite perfect slip, but it's closer to perfect slip, as I recall, than to stick. All right, but for big particles like this, the stick boundary conditions are good if you're working in a simple liquid like water. All right, you might expect something different, say, in a complex fluid, but let's not go there. We could talk about it, but we'll talk about it another time, maybe. Okay, so that went on even longer than I expected, because you guys are interested in it, I guess. But it's something to know, and now you know something, that about 90% of the people, or 95% of the people working on colloids, have wrong. All right? So. Let me give you. So the question is, this Einstein relation, how did Einstein derive it? Einstein didn't use a Langevin equation at all right? And he derived it in a different way. Suppose you have a beaker full of liquid, say water, and then you have a colloidal suspension in it. One thing you can ask is, all right, and then you have gravity acting down. So say the particles, just for the sake of argument, are a little more dense than the fluid. So that should pull the particles down. Now, what's the concentration of the particles as a function of height? So let's call height z. All right, well, you know that in general, this ought to be, at least if you're at equilibrium, it ought to be controlled by a Boltzmann factor. So you expect that the probability of finding a particle at a height z is going to be some amplitude times e to the minus u of z over kt, your usual Boltzmann factor. Here, u of z is equal to delta m g z, all right, where delta m is the mass of the particle minus the mass of the solvent that it displaces. So this is just Archimedes. All right. So this is just going to be P naught e to the minus m or delta m g z over kBT, or I can write this as P naught e to the minus z over hg, where I define hg as kBT over delta mg. All right. Now, if I want, delta m is 4/3 pi r cubed, rho, the density of the fluid, the mass density of the fluid, or mass density of the particle minus the mass density of the fluid. All right. So you can plug that in. But what it means is that this gravitational height goes as 1 over r cubed. All right, so the smaller the particle, the greater the gravitational height. But basically what this is saying, the probability then is just going to be proportional to the concentration. So if I plot up, say, the number density of particles, or you could do volume fraction too, what you're going to get is an exponential. So it's going to go like this, and the exponential and the slope of this, or the how fast it goes down, is determined by what the gravitational height is. All right. Now, what what Einstein said was the following. He said, if you look at this in equilibrium, you have two fluxes, which I'll write as a current, J. You have a flux up that's diffusive, all right? In other words, you have minus D, the diffusion coefficient of the particles, times the gradient in the concentration, dc dz. All right, so you have that flux. So you have a concentration gradient, so diffusion will tend to take those particles up. But then there'll be the gravity is acting on these, which will tend to produce a sedimentation velocity, all right, which we'll write as plus the density at height z, all right, times the sedimentation velocity, all right, and that should equal zero. Now the sedimentation velocity of particles, if it's not too dense, you can just get by saying that when a particle is sedimenting at constant velocity, the force is the minus drag force that we had before. Now, this time the drag force is constant because we assume it's been settling for a long time, minus mg is equal to zero. So that says that the sedimentation velocity s should be delta mg, right? That says that the sedimentation velocity is delta mg over the friction coefficient. Okay, so if we put that in, we can do a couple things. Let's we're going to put this into here, and then we're going to take this other result we had that that the concentration is equal to e to the minus z over hg. If we take dn dz, we get minus n0 over hg times this factor again, so we just get n. All right, so dn dz is just minus n over hg. All right, so putting that in, we get that this is minus d times minus n over hg, all right, plus n times delta mg over zeta equals 0. All right, so the n's cancel out. And let's see. What I want to note here is that hg is equal to kbt over delta mg. All right. So what I have here now is that minus d, these minuses cancel each other out, and 1 over hg is delta mg over kbt, the n's cancel out, plus delta mg over zeta, this equals 0. These cancel out, and somehow I've screwed up. No, actually, I think I'm okay. So now what I get is So now what I get is that d, solving for d here, I get d is equal to, rats. I haven't made a mistake, but I didn't do it the way I wanted to do it. Let me just back up, as I forgot what I want to do. Let me leave this as Vs, all right? If I leave this as Vs, all right, then I get the n's to cancel out here, and I get that d is equal to hg times Vs. There's a minus sign here because Vs is negative, but if you want, you can put an absolute value like this. And what you see is that the diffusion coefficient now is equal to the gravitational height times the sedimentation velocity. All right? And if you put in then our expressions for those, so if you say d is equal to the gravitational height times the sedimentation velocity, the gravitational height was kbt over delta mg, and the sedimentation velocity was delta mg over the friction coefficient. So d is now kbt over zeta. All right. So it's another way of getting the diffusion behavior. So this is what Einstein did in his classic paper on Brownian motion back 110 years ago, I guess it was now. And you note that his argument completely avoids any discussion about early time behavior or anything like that. It's only looking at the steady state, essentially at the equilibrium behavior, and so no mistakes are made, and he gets the right answer. All right, so this was the first derivation of this expression. All right, and it gives you a little bit of insight into how colloids work. You have the sedimentation velocity, you have this gravitational height, the diffusion coefficient is just the product of those two characteristic numbers. All right. So, okay, so let's Let me just pause. Are there any questions about this? Okay, so what I want to do for the remainder of the time in this lecture and then in the later lecture is to talk about colloidal interactions, all right? And let me just give you a quick preview so that you know where we're going. So, we're going to talk about the coulomb or the screened coulomb interaction. All right. It turns out that most, not all, but most colloids are charged. And as such, they feel, in general, if they're all of the same type, they'll all have the same charge, and they'll feel a repulsion from each other. All right, repulsion has some subtle aspects to it that have to do with entropy. All right, so we're going to discuss the screen-Coulomb interaction. Then we're going to discuss the van der Waals interaction. All right. These two, all right, the van der Waals interaction, actually we're going to discuss, I'm going to do it in the other order. We're going to discuss the van der Waals interaction first and then the screen-Coulomb interaction. The van der Waals interaction is always present, always, 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 all right? And it is attractive with a few caveats about that. But because the van der Waals interaction is attractive, and it's always there. It's the only interaction that has to be there. So if it is there, and that's the only interaction you have, your colloids are unstable, all right, because they attract each other. And so what happens is they'll aggregate, turn into a big mass, and fall to the bottom, all right? So it turns out that this brings us to the topic of colloidal stability. So if ever you read about colloids, there'll be a big section and a big discussion about colloidal stability, because it's a big issue, because you always have van der Waals. Unless you do something about it, it will make your colloidal suspension unstable. All right. The most common solution is to charge up the colloids. All right. And so if they all have the same charge, they repel each other. And if they have enough charge on them and the conditions are right, which we'll talk about, the Coulomb repulsion is enough to counteract the van der Waals attraction and your colloids are stable. These two forces taken together form what's known as DLVO theory. This is for Daryagin and Landau, two Russian theorists who worked on this in the 40s and 50s, and for Verwey and Overbeek, two Dutch chemists, actually, who worked on this and during the same period of time. All right, and they came up more or less with the same theory. All right, so this is called DLVO theory. It's fundamental, basic to colloid science. Then we're going to talk about something called the depletion interaction. The depletion interaction was first described theoretically in 1953. It was then ignored until the 1980s. All right. In the 80s, colloid scientists discovered this thing or rediscovered the depletion interaction. And now it's used all the time. It is one of the most powerful tools used over the last 40 years, or no, actually not 40, 30 years, in controlling colloid behavior. I'll show you some research we've done in my group on it just in the last few years. We got some really, really cool things happening in colloids based on the depletion interaction. So these two are basic. This one is extremely useful, and it's made a huge difference in how we think about colloids since people started to understand it around 1985, people started developing a more sophisticated way of understanding it. So we're going to talk about that. And then if there's time, if not this lecture, the next lecture, we'll talk about a type of interaction that's even newer, and that's DNA coded colloids. This is something that's still under development, all right, in terms of actually using DNA coded colloids as something to direct their assembly. It has its origins about 20 years ago, but it's really only been in the last 10 years that it's been developed significantly, and its development is ongoing. There's new things coming out all the time, so this brings us up right up to the most current things going on with colloidal interactions. So we're going to talk about these four interactions. It'll probably take us into not just the lecture this afternoon, but beyond that. All right. So that's what we're going to be looking at. So let's start out in the 15 minutes we have left. Actually, do I have 15 minutes? I mean, it says quarter of 11, right? Just want to make sure I understand this okay. So what I want to talk about first is the van der Waals interaction. And this should go under fluctuating induced dipoles, electric dipoles. So suppose I have some material here. This happened in liquids too, but let's imagine we have a colloid, a small colloid, all right? And it's a dielectric material, all right? So actually, I'll make it bigger. So it has the dielectric constant EC for colloid. I think that's what I called it in my notes. All right, let's say that. It has, as a dielectric material, it has charges inside, electrons in particular, that can be polarized. And just because of thermal fluctuations, there will be thermal fluctuations in the dielectric, in the dipole moment of this colloid. All right. So say at a particular time, it has a dipole moment pointing that way, just through these random thermal fluctuations. Now suppose there's another colloid over here. This colloid over here will see the field from this one, and that will induce a dipole moment in this one. Now if you think about it, the dipole moment looks something like this. And when it goes over here, it looks something like this. So it'll induce a dipole moment, say, pointing down like that. All right. Now, if you think about it, it's induced a dipole moment over here. This dipole moment and this dipole moment, the way I've drawn it, are oppositely oriented. And so they'll be a net attraction, a net dipole-dipole interaction. What you have is over here this this moment P, let's call this P1 for particle 1. Let's call this this particle 2, this is particle 1. So the dipole moment of P2 will be proportional to the polarizability times the electric field from particle 1, and the electric field from particle 1, of course, is a dipole field, so it falls off as R cubed. All right, so this field falls off as R cubed. All right, now, the interaction energy, U12, goes as P1, P2 over R cubed. There's a minus sign because it's attractive. All right. Since P2 goes as 1 over R cubed, this this interaction is going to go as 1 over R to the sixth. All right. So this is characteristic of a of the van der Waals attraction, is that the dipole-dipole interaction between when the second dipole is induced by the first dipole gives you a 1 over 6th behavior. Now, there's more complicated stuff you can say about it, because if this particle is too far away, the light travel time comes in and you get what are called retardation effects, and this r to the 6th becomes a 1 over r to the 7th. It's never of any consequence for colloids, as far as I know. All right, so I wouldn't worry about that too much. But if you want to calculate the total interaction energy between these two colloids as a function of R, it's usually written like this: AH over pi squared times the integral of 1 times the integral over dv1, the integral over dv2, so this is over particle 1, over its volume, over particle 2, over 1 over r to the 6th. All right. So this constant AH I'll talk about in a second, but it takes into account all the prefactors, all right, the things like the polarizability of the different materials. All right. I'll come to that in a second. But the bare interaction between these two is written as A sub H over pi squared times 1 over R to the 6th. And the R to the 6th just comes from this argument here. So all the material properties are thrown into this thing. It's called the Hamaker constant. All right. So AH is it depends upon the materials. Now, but before we do that, I want to show you something else. So the point is, if I have what the idea of these integrals is the 1 over r to the 6th is an interaction between point dipoles. All right. So to get the interaction over the colloids, what you imagine doing is breaking it up into little small volumes that are essentially point dipoles. And what this double integral is doing is it's just adding up the contribution here with this one, of this one with that one. It's just integrating over all those possible things. So this is important because of these volume integrals, you're going to expect that our energy here is going to depend not only on the material properties of the colloids, which are in AH, but also on the size of the colloids. All right? It depends how big the colloids are. Now, AH, the theory of the AH would take about two or three lectures to develop, all right? But I can tell you the answer and motivate it physically. So the Hamaker constant is 3 halves KBT. KBT has to come into this. Why? Because KBT is what's responsible for creating the fluctuations in the dipole moment. All right. So like I said before, KT comes into almost every interaction that you see in soft matter. All right. Then it turns out it's a sum over frequencies of epsilon 1 minus epsilon m over epsilon 1 plus epsilon m times epsilon 2 minus epsilon m over epsilon 2 plus epsilon m. All right. I didn't write it in, but these things are frequency dependent. What frequencies do you take into account? Zero to infinity. All right. Actually, it turns out to be a sum because, again, in doing the analysis of this, you do a Laplace transform, and in doing the Laplace transform, I guess it's a Fourier transform, you end up doing a bunch of contour integrals, you get a bunch of residues. The residues are at a finite spectrum of frequencies, but that finite spectrum spans from zero to infinity, and that's what that sum is all about. All right, so that's why it's a little bit complicated to develop. It's just there's a fair bit of algebra. But the important thing to understand is that all of these are frequency dependent. It turns out, maybe somewhat surprisingly, that in most cases, the frequencies that are the most important are optical frequencies. All right, those are the frequencies where the fluctuations give you the biggest contribution to the Hamburger constant. Now, epsilon 1 is the dielectric constant of particle 1, epsilon 2 is the dielectric constant of particle 2, and epsilon m is the dielectric constant of the medium of water, say. All right, now, oh, and I forgot, notice there's a minus sign here. All right, so if AH is positive, the van der Waals interaction is attractive. Now, normally that will be the case because normally the two colloids are made out of the same material. So whether E1 is bigger or smaller than EM, the fact that E1 appears in both places means that this is squared and the Hamburger constant is always positive. However, if the two particles are different or the two materials are different, and one has a Hamburger, one has a dielectric constant that's smaller than that of the medium, and the other one has one that's bigger than the medium, then the van der Waals force actually becomes repulsive. And we'll see a little bit about this when we talk about surfactants. All right, there are cases where you get surfactant coatings on solid substrates where the substrate and the liquid that the surfactant sits in have dielectric constants that are different, and the dielectric constant of the surfactant is in between the two, and so you actually get a repulsive interaction. It's called something called disjoining pressure. So if we have time, we'll talk about that in subsequent lectures. But for colloids, normally all the particles are made of the same stuff, and so the van der Waals attraction the van der Waals interaction is attractive. Even when you use different materials, like polystyrene and PMMA and silica, they all tend to have dielectric constants that are bigger than that of the of water, at least, and so that so it tends to be positive. There's one other thing to take away from this. Remember I said the biggest contributions to the van der Waals interaction are at the frequencies that are optical frequencies. So what that means is if I have a colloidal suspension and I match the refractive index of the solvent to that of the particles, I can minimize AH. I can make it very small. So you can actually make the van der Waals interaction very small by index matching your particles. And that is something that people do, and they're quite cognizant of the fact that they're doing it and that they're reducing this van der Waals interaction. Now, one other thing I want to point out. All right, so you can perform this integral. I'll give you the result for two spheres that are close to each other. So the two spheres, let's say, they're separated by a distance h. All right. So if they're separated by a distance h, you actually, I remember to within a factor of pi, but it looks like I may be missing a page of notes. That's okay. All right. My recollection is this, that the van der Waals interaction for two spheres of radius r, is equal to r over h times ah over 12. All right. So what you see is that it depends on the particle size. It depends on how far they are apart. Now, it's interesting to look at this. All right. AH, if you take polystyrene, AH is approximately 10 kT. Most materials for polystyrene and water, you actually have to find out what AH is for polystyrene and water. It's the order of 10 kT. Typically, that's a sort of typical value for the Heimacher constant. All right, so if you have a radius, say, of 500 nanometers, all right, so a 1 micron particle, and an h, say, of 1 nanometer, all right, so these get very close to each other, then you see that this is 10 kT over 12, times 500 over 1. So the 10 over 12 is approximately 1. This is 500. So you see that this is on the order of 500 kT. All right? And that's absolutely typical. So this van der Waals attraction for colloids is huge, 500 kT. So if they get within a nanometer of each other, it's history, all right? They stick to each other, and they're not going to come undone, all right? And that's why colloids are unstable. I have negative 1 minute, but I want to do one more. That's good anyway. I want to do one more picture, all right? This is what happens when all you have is van der Waals interaction. This is what your colloidal suspension will look like. If you look at the particles in your colloidal suspension under an electron microscope. And then we're done. You can get some tea, cookies. Not going to work? All right, what I'm going to show you is a picture that appeared in Physical Review Letters, volume 54, page 1416, in 1985. And this is the picture that made Dave Waits famous, all right, when he was a very young person. So if all you have is van der Waals forces, and you have a colloidal suspension, and you let the particles do what they want to do, they aggregate, all right? And what they make is, so this is an electron micrograph of gold nanoparticles taken from a colloidal suspension of gold, all right, that was made to aggregate by adding salt. When you add salt to it, it turns out it screens the charges that repel each other, and these things start to aggregate, and they make pictures that look like this. While this might look ugly, it's actually kind of pretty if you look at it in the right way. And in particular, those of you who are familiar with the idea of fractals, fractional dimensions, Dave and his collaborators were able to show that these aggregates like this had a fractal dimension of slightly less than 2 under some circumstances, and slightly more than 2 under other circumstances. This is one of the few real quantitative scientific uses of the idea of fractals, where you actually can develop a theory and predict that as random as these shapes look, they're not completely random, you can predict the fractal dimension. The fractal dimension, by the way, just has to do, if you start drawing circles around here and ask how much mass is inside the circle and how does that mass scale with distance, all right? If you have a solid object in three dimensions, that's, it should just scale with power 3, because the bigger you make your radius, the more material you have, the volume increases as a power of 3. If it's constant density, then the material increases with a power 3. For these aggregates, when you increase it, these three, they're actually three-dimensional aggregates, they increase with a power of a little bit less than 2, and so we say they have a fractional dimensionality of a little less than 2. So at any rate, that's what happens when all you have is van der Waals forces. This afternoon we'll talk about the charge forces and the depletion interaction. The depletion interaction is particularly interesting. I think you'll find some rather neat stuff there. So that's it for this morning. Okay.